I am very glad that I have here with me two of the brightest masterminds of the world. And we are doing this show in English because we have a special guest, Ms. Lorraine Carter, Persona Branding and Design Founder. Hello.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here.
Thank you for being here, and also with your friend and business partner, Ozana Jushka, entrepreneur. Hello, Ozana.
Hello, nice to see you again.
So it will be interesting for us to do a show in English. And we are doing our best to give to our audience and to the entrepreneurs in particular some insights and some tools about how to increase their business, their impact in the world, and also their personal image, because I understand you are one of the top experts in the world in branding.
Well, thank you very much, Alexandru. Well, we effectively work with business leaders, owners, and entrepreneurs to help them make their brand, whether it's product, service, or corporate entity, their ideal customer's favorite brand. And then we empower them to become super savvy brand builders themselves. So they become highly informed about managing, developing, and scaling their brand, which underpins their whole business. And we do all of this using an agile brand strategy based on big brand know-how.
Did you had until now any media client?
No.
Because it is a challenge to do Channel 43, the most popular and loved Romanian media brand. So I
guess you're going to get some free consulting for yourself tonight.
Yes, of course. So how have you two start working together, and what kind of projects have you done until now in Romania, and what do you have in preparation for us?
Well, we met at a public speaking course, and we realized that we complement each other. We have the same values, which was the most important. And we just clicked and we said, okay, you know part of the business, I know part of the business, so it makes sense to complement each other, work together, and help others as well with the expertise that we both have. And Lorraine is for the fourth time in Romania
fourth
now.
Fourth time?
Yeah. Yeah. She did some master classes, some boot camps here, and she also worked with our brand. She kept bugging me for like a year or so, like, you don't look good. Look at this, they don't match. It's not right, you're not visible. You are there, but you're not visible. I'm like, no, I am there, I'm visible. I couldn't get it for a year.
So you are an entrepreneur that is very attached to his baby.
Exactly.
And you love doing things your way.
Yeah.
And you said this is not so.
And you have to be really careful when you say that to people so you don't upset them. Because
they
entrepreneurs, and business owners, particularly for SMEs, their business is their baby with smaller businesses. So you have to be very careful. But there's always room for improvement. And a lot of times, successful business people are so caught up with building the business, scaling it, managing the daily operations that frequently, because they don't have the time and resources, giving the consideration around strategic thinking about their brand is often something that gets overlooked or there just isn't time. So with quite a bit of nudging, we eventually got Ozana to work much more on brand and be much more strategic about her brand.
And sometimes people who own small businesses said, I don't have money for this kind of nice to have services. So they do a lousy logo and they pay for it $50 to a student. Yeah. And after that, the business grows, and it grows with that image.
But it grows with struggle because the foundation is not there. With a 50 euros logo and nothing else worked on the brand, I don't think you can build a proper business these days. It's branding, I've learned from Lorraine that it's not just about the logo, it's the whole thing, it's literally the whole thing.
How do you start? if somebody is in the wonderful position not to be in a storm with his business, but thinks about starting a business by the book,
Yeah.
How should he start?
Really, to build a successful brand, there are 12 key areas that we address in mapping out a brand for a business. And none of it's to do with the visual expression. So you're looking at things like, well, what is the bigger reason as to why your brand is here? What's the bigger purpose? What's your raison d'etre? That really big reason of why you're doing what you're doing in the world. And what's your key differentiators?
Do you think people ask themselves that?
No.
They say, I want to make a buck.
They go in business because they want to make money or because they have an opportunity. Mm. And when they ask, when they are asked, like, okay, why are you here? Well, because I don't want a bad job or a bad boss. I want to make money. I want to grow. I want to become powerful. I want to have a big building with loads of offices.
Sports but they actually cars, exactly nice yeah. women.
But they're still
but they
a
don't
pig.
Think of the impact and the reason why that business is actually should be there.
And if you do that, you push the business every minute of your life, but if you have a higher purpose, it pulls you a little bit.
And it's also even more important now if you take the younger generation, like millennials. For them, the bigger reason, it's got to be more than just making money. And if you look at the statistics, the most successful enterprises in the world are driven by a bigger purpose, not just for making money. Yes, making money is hugely important, and we all like to have more money, but there's more to life than just that as well. And for the compelling reasons as to why your business is doing what it does and why it attracts and resonates with its ideal
you
customers.
You know that joke, it is said that Bill Gates had a kind of quote, 20 years ago I thought money is the most important thing in the world. Now I'm thinking I was right. I don't know if it's true or not, maybe it's just a joke, he might not have been said that, but to have a higher purpose inspires people to work for you, with you, to buy your goods and services.
That's the reason why, because when you emotionally resonate with people at a deeper level, they become more engaged with you, so their reasons for buying you become emotionally, buying what you have to offer become emotionally driven. And fundamentally, regardless of gender or your cultural background, we are all driven by emotional decisions. Everything we do, personally and professionally, is driven by an emotional decision. So one of the key secrets to a really successful brand is understanding the emotional drivers behind why your core target audience will potentially buy what you have to offer. And then when you understand that at a deeper level, your business becomes far more successful.
Well, I would just add something. It's not just to understand them, but you also communicate them.
Yes.
So you understand, so you can then have the right messages to
not
the
only
right
on your corporate wall.
No.
Yeah.
It's in everything. Everything you do incorporates those reasons.
You've got to live it. I mean, for example, I'll give you a tip here now to share with your viewers. Is typically we're all driven by three different key pain points. And most businesses... Pain points in terms of problems and challenges. So typically, most businesses address what's the obvious generic problem. And then everybody's doing the same thing. But the reality of it is there's a deeper level of conflict in all of us and pain points that drives why we do what we do. And when you understand that as a brand owner, what it is that's driving your customers to make those decisions, and then you communicate with them on those terms, they feel far more engaged and they feel that you really understand them.
You speak their language.
You're speaking their language. So they're feeling like, I'd be mad to go anywhere else. These guys just so understand what I need.
So it's a lot of it's a lot of psychology here.
Yes, huge amount. Brand is driven by a huge amount of psychology, yes.
So, what is the pain you address the most in your business?
Well, there are two, not having enough and still struggling. So there are entrepreneurs that who come our way, it's either because they want to go to the next level, they want more success, more power, more money, more of whatever, so that means they don't have enough of what they have. And the other one is that they're still struggling, they still can't pay their bills, they still work too much and for very little money. Those are the two main pain points for us.
Now we are living in a changing world. It used to be the world of hard goods and oil companies and automotives and iron companies and so on. And now it's technology, it's air.
Yes.
It's how does this change the branding, the relationship with the consumer and so on?
Fundamentally, the principles, and we work with companies across all a huge variation of sectors, including traditional businesses and technology. And right now we're working with a business that's a 50-year-old bakery business, which is hugely traditional, but we're also working with somebody in the tech sector. So the principles are the same. It's just the, and fundamentally, the reasons why their customers buy what they have to offer is still driven by emotions, and it's understanding what those emotional drivers are. That's on the basis, of course, that you are delivering on your product and service. But in a world whereby there's so much competition, for you to stand out, you've got to have something that's significantly different and that connects with your audience in a way that really matters to them. And then you leverage and amplify that even further. So you build a deeper relationship. So there's actually more opportunities now for smaller businesses than ever before. They have, the playing field has been leveled by technology. So small businesses now have far more opportunities, and they can leverage that big brand know-how on a very lean basis and get great results, because the technology enables them to do it, but you still have to have the strategic thinking behind it.
I saw an ad, an outdoor, to a restaurant, and it reminds me of your bakery. They said, you cannot download your lunch, come here and eat.
But this bakery business, I didn't tell you about this, Ozana, but this bakery business, they've just been through, and these are businesses that are already seven-figure businesses, they're already successful. This particular business, she's got 120-odd staff, the business is around for 50 years, traditional bakery, but she's recognized that her biggest growth areas now are online. And the growth, the online side of the business has gradually been slowly growing over the last few years, but she's got 10 physical outlets as well. But they've recognized that that's where their future of the business ultimately lies. So they now, their starting point for their online offering is €50 for a cake up to about €300. And that's selling to a retail consumer, not business, this is selling to a retail consumer, and that's where their biggest growth is coming in the business now. She just finished in June with us a 12-week program to completely reevaluate their brand strategy, which we deliver online, live. And she, one of the big aha moments was, you know, we need to take our cheaper products off online, because they take so much, they take as much work to produce as the bigger, more expensive products. And the margin is much smaller on the sale. And their staff is going, you can't be serious, Sinead. You're taking all of those off. We're taking them off this weekend. She took them off and completely filled the capacity with the higher value offering and doubled her sales that weekend, because she had the higher, only the higher margin product available, starting at €50 per cake.
But
can I just add something to what Lorraine said earlier? Because she said there are loads of opportunities, which I totally agree. But on the other side, on the flip side of the coin is that it's also not that easy to start if you don't do the right things.
Yes.
And she mentioned strategy, right? It's loads of people like, oh, okay, I can do a Facebook ad, or I can do a post and I can reach through social media to loads of people and I can sell my product. No, it doesn't work that way. Unless you have the strategy and the thinking behind, that whatever you do on social media sucks and doesn't give you any results. And that's what I learned from Lorraine, to have consistency across the board, everywhere I am, online, offline, every platform on social media or YouTube, everywhere. It's the same message, it's the same image, it's the same colors, it's the same everywhere, consistency. That is a key point which most entrepreneurs don't understand. They just think, okay, I'm going to get somebody to do SEO on my website and clients will
and
flow.
Now and I realize you're dressed in your logo colors.
It's the purple, right?
Yes.
But you know why consistency is so so important, Alexandra? When you don't have consistency, it undermines trust. Because somebody thinks, well, that is not the same as how I saw it over there. Do they really know what they're about? And if you don't have trust, people don't buy. So every time I'm evaluating a business or a brand, one of the most common challenges I see every time is a lack of consistency for wherever the brand is engaging, whether it's through its people, whether it's through its social interaction online or its website or it's through physical product. If there's inconsistency, it plants distrust, and then people do not buy, or at least they are hesitant to buy. Because the more trust you can build with your customers, the more successful your
brand
will be.
But you have to choose. You have the guts to say, I don't sell to these people. Mm. I say, I sell only to these people. Mm. And I communicate in a manner that is relevant to them. If I want to communicate with this and this, and they are very different things.
Yes.
You create this discrepancy in your message.
But you can, well, you see, every brand has its core brand language and messaging and key engage and key way with its personality in terms of how it engages in the marketplace. But when you've got your brand really well mapped out, you then can fine tune it for different audiences, because every business has a minimum of 2 customer types or profiles, but can have up to 20. So you map out your different customer profiles, and then you build very targeted communications for those specific kinds of buyers, so that they are getting communications that are really relevant to them. Because no business can have just one blanket communication that's going to be relevant to all their customers. So it's about fine-tuning it.
I'd like to give some examples to what you've discussed earlier, because now that I've learned it, I've seen it, and I see why so many people come to us not having enough of the sales and the profits they want. And there, this kind of mismatches, what I call them, the discrepancies between how they between their product and how they present the product. That's the biggest, one of the biggest things that holds many entrepreneurs in Romania in particular. And I give you an example. One of our clients came to one of my boot camps to build their presence online and build sales funnels. They sell a very good, high quality Japanese machines. But their website was done 20 years ago, and it looks really crap. There is no trust that anybody could go into, or when you look at it, it's like, okay, this is something that was done 20 years ago, I'm not going to buy. So you can build the best ads in the world, you can build the best sales funnel in the world, with that crappy website, nobody's going to buy. Because there is one, it's enough to have one link in your website that is so weak, that is so out of everything else, that it destroys the whole reputation and the whole trust, and then people don't buy. They don't say, oh, I don't buy because I don't like the website. They just don't buy. They, in subconscious level, they don't think why they don't buy. They just don't buy.
It's a subconscious decision, because we all innately, when we meet people, we kind of have a sense of whether we like them or we don't like them, whether we feel like we're going to build trust with them. And building a brand is all about really humanizing what you have to offer, so that it builds that engagement. So you're looking at everything you do to be really consistent. So if you're going to invest effort and energy into building out a sales funnel, then you need to make sure that everything else that's going to be on the receiving end of that lives up and exceeds expectations.
But what if the brand and the business is yourself?
Even easier.
You are a showbiz person or a speaker or a politician.
You still need to have your personal brand really clearly articulated and mapped out. I mean, very commonly when we work with, and we do a lot of work with SME businesses, and say we've worked the process of mapping out their brand strategy, and that's fully documented and it's underpinning all the key business decisions now. It's been implemented in communications. But it's not unusual whereby I might have been working with a leadership team, and there's a couple on that team who are, let's call them, off-brand. They're not ideally resonating with the brand, so they potentially become a risk to the business. So you can't pick 2 people out and say, well, out of 10 of you, you 2 guys are off-brand. So when we go through, as we go through a process of reevaluating the personal brand to align it to the corporate entity brand, to mitigate risk and to reduce risk and to perform at a much higher level. So when managing a personal brand is a similar process of evaluating 12 key areas and then looking at them in terms of how you get really clear about What are your strong points? What do you want to reduce your weaknesses? How are you going to resonate and articulate and communicate in a way that's appropriate to your target audience? Where are your strengths and weaknesses? How are you going to leverage them? What are your differences
and,
in the market?
With a speaker or a showman or just one-man show, I would say it's very, very important to look at who you are as a person, to look inside and really understand, go to the essence of you as a person, and articulate that very well with your own values, your own beliefs, and then create the messages that resonate.
You have a story.
You have to have your story, of course. You have to tell your story and your key messages all the time. And there, again, there are so many mismatches that people have. Like, you'd have someone like this selling nutrition advice. You can't. Nobody would buy nutrition advice from someone who is 150 kilograms, right? That's an obvious mismatch. But the non-obvious ones are a lot of the people, especially in Romania, they pretend that they are someone that they are not. And the audience would very easily pick up on the signals, and they don't buy just because they realize that the person is not who they are. So from my point of view, it's better to be authentic and say, okay, I've only achieved this. I haven't achieved this and that, but that's okay. We're here all in a journey. Mm-hmm. And if I've only achieved from 10 steps, I've only achieved 3, that's fine. I'm going to speak to people who have only achieved 1 or 2. When I achieve 10 or 7, then I speak to people who have achieved 6, up to 6. But I can't be at level 3 and target people who are at level 7.
And fake it, trying to fake it.
You can't. People are super smart these days, and they can pick up very easily, and they just don't buy.
Plus, it's very easy to find out a lot of information online. You know, it's very hard. It's very difficult to really cover up anything, because pretty much everything, if you're living in any way in social media where pretty much everything shows up, and if you don't show up authentically as who you say you are, then the world is going to realize that.
But
and it can backfire on you, and it actually did on me. When I initially started, I learned from the gurus who tell you how to sell and how to lie to sell. So I was pretending different things, and I got loads of bad negative comments on what I was doing, because people are smart. So it took me a long time to move away from the negative feedback or comments or reviews that I received at the time, and build it slowly towards me, authentic me, which I'm not at 10. Everybody in their own development, nobody's at 10, like from 1 to 10 in the development, right? You are somewhere on the journey. So you just have to accept that you are at wherever you are, and there are still more steps to go. Even when you reach where you want to reach, then your next target will become bigger. So again, you're not at 10 again. So you're always in a journey, and you just have to be honest and accept that everybody's on a journey.
It is a joke in Romania, but I don't know if you, maybe you will understand it, because at the 10, it's, some say 10 is the grade
the
of the teacher.
No, the God.
I was making my way to God. There is a famous business person, politician, football team owner, a charismatic guy, but he has a very impressive personality. He is very, very expressive. So, and it is a joke that he came to the door of the heaven. He knocks, and the Saint Peter comes and asks, "Who is there?" And he said his name, Gigi Becali. Tell God I'm here. And Saint Peter goes to God and said, "Is somebody at the door?" And he pretends he's Gigi Becali. And God said, "Forget about it, it's a liar. I am Gigi Becali." So even God, maybe he's at 10 or no.
Maybe at 9.
So, but at the smaller businesses, it is an advantage or a disadvantage for the owner to try to be the image of his business, her business?
Ideally, it's better for the owner to be the voice and visionary behind the brand, but not to be the brand, because you reduce your options later on, whether you're deciding whether you want to sell the business or whether you want to bring investors on board. When the business is being valued, And if the business is too closely tied up in the founder, and that is the predominant brand, if the founder leaves the business, then it's seen that part of the business disappears with the founder. So a business can end up being sold for at least 30% below its real value because the founder or original owner is too tightly tied up in it. And that's for your typical SME. Now, obviously, there are always exceptions to that rule. So my recommendation to business owners is be a really strong voice behind the brand, be the visionary, but try and build a standalone asset so you have more options later on in terms of what you might want to do with the business down the road, whether it's selling it or bringing investors on board. You just have more choices when the whole business isn't too tightly tied up in your personal brand.
And again, I'd like to go with an example. Like, for example, Richard Branson, he has a very strong personal brand, but he is the voice behind the business, right? The business is not him. Whereas with Tony Robbins' type, the business is him. It's also two strong brands. And what Lorraine is saying, that everything that Richard Branson builds is going to be sold for bigger money than whatever Tony Robbins builds, because what Tony Robbins builds is around himself. And it's very hard for him to extract himself.
Of course, he has a team of other speakers and guests and so on, but everybody is there for him at the end of the day.
But when you
take him out of the equation, is
But when you look at the Virgin brand and you look at how many different sectors it operates in, through so many different parts of the world, that brand is far more scalable across multiple different sectors, product and service, on and offline in its offering, because it's a standalone brand.
And you know, actually, we had this conversation with Lorraine about a year ago, because I was building the business around my brand at the time, because I realized why. I realized that even though she gave me some really good advice, I ignored it. And I realized that I was driven by my need of significance.
I know why you ignore it.
Because of the ego.
Do you want me to tell you?
Why?
She didn't charge you $1 million.
Exactly.
For it.
I must remember that now, Ozan. Every time I give you significant advice,
you need to ask
put
for
a few
money
on the end of it, and then she'll value it.
Yes.
It's like every entrepreneur, right? Oh, no, that's not for me. I'm good. I know what I'm doing. That's what every entrepreneur does, right? Until something happens.
I do have some online courses, and I have one that is with a huge tax. Enormous, outrageous, and other normal taxes. The persons who paid that absurd tax are the most determined. They do their work. They're putting value into
exactly.
that.
Exactly. Yeah.
So I started to believe. Of course, you cannot put a high tax except to a small audience that actually allows that tax and believes enough in investing in that to put the time and the work and actually
to get the results.
Yes. Yeah. Otherwise, they will treat it as a commodity.
Yes, you're totally right. If you don't have to pay something of significance, it's not valued. So people don't put the effort in.
But you are first time in Romania.
That's right, yes.
Okay, so you had some image now about our pains as Romanian entrepreneurs.
I wouldn't say I know them that well now.
So
a little bit, but not that well.
How do you, what are our main things to work with, our areas to address the
I think you've lots of opportunities because, unlike other parts of Europe which have more developed economies, Romania's got more of an emerging economy. But you've certainly got the edge in other areas in terms of online. Definitely your internet here is way better than what we have in Ireland, absolutely far better. But you have opportunities because you now can leverage newer thinking and strategies and processes without making the old mistakes, learn from the old mistakes, and move faster because you're not carrying the legacy of older ways of doing things. So you can adopt that newer way of thinking and you can do things on a very lean, agile basis. So there's more opportunities, I think, now for SMEs here now than, say, 20 years ago because of online. So regardless of whether you're running a traditional business or an online business, as with that example of that business, Thunder's Bakery, they can still become really successful even if it's more of a traditional business.
Well, then, we're going toward the end of the show. We have still some time, but not a lot, because time flies away with you.
When you're having fun.
And I want you to speak a little bit about the event in this fall. You are preparing a new big event in Romania with wonderful speakers like Lorraine, who will not be in that particular event, I understand, probably.
At the moment, we're just looking at dates in terms of challenges with dates at the moment.
But we can see what does it mean for us as Romanians to have access to this
kind of advice,
yes.
Well, the point of this Smart Business Summit is because I had my own challenges and I struggled a lot. I got a lot of bad advice and only a little bit of good advice. And I could not make the difference between the bad advice and the good advice. So I want to bring to Romanians the mentors that I learned a lot from, people who are really knowledgeable and good experts in their field and share their expertise, the proper expertise which is being developed and progressed in the US and in London. And I want that expertise to be available for very, very little money to anyone in Romania who wants to start a business or wants to take the business to the next level. So basically, the point of this event is to give to Romanian entrepreneurs what I was looking for many years ago. And I don't want this event to be like, oh, come to another conference, boring, listen to some presentations, go home, and that's it. This is going to be fun. This is going to be interactive and very practical. So yes, we will have the four keynotes with proper like 60 minutes presentations, but we will also have a lot of interaction in between the guests and the speakers. So we'll, for example, people will do their own video. I know I struggled with my videos, my first videos. I remember I understood long time ago that it's good to be on video because it gives you more visibility, people consume your content. And it took me one day to produce like 5 videos of 3 minutes each. And that's because I was not comfortable with the camera, because I didn't know what to say, how to say. It was a complete mess. And those videos, once I produced them, they're really good content from my point of view. But everybody who looked at them were like, no. I was like, really? I worked one day for those videos and they're not good. Look at this knowledge. Yeah, but no. And then it took me a while to accept that they were bad and to understand what to make difference. So that's why in the summit, people will have their video, regardless of having been on camera before or not, regardless of being scared of camera, they'll have their videos and they'll have good videos. Because it's actually when you have the right tools and you have the guidelines, you do it properly and it's very, very easy. So that's one of the things. Then there will be a competition for money. Bill Walsh, one of the mentors, is very willing to invest in Romanian entrepreneurs. So
he's a business angel as well?
Yeah, he's a venture capitalist and an entrepreneur himself, and he has loads of interest in loads of businesses. His net worth is $100 million, okay? He flies private jet and completely different ball game to the startups.
And I fly private jet, so
well done.
In my dreams, what?
Well, he does it on a day. I flew private jet, not in my dreams, in reality, but I flew during a period of time when my business was really going thriving, right? He does it every day, every time. So so he wants to invest. There will be a pitch competition with people looking for funding where he will be their partner. So that means that he's going to promote their business to 500,000 entrepreneurs that he's in touch with in Europe and in the US. And he's also going to, but that's value of like 30,000, right? And euros. And he's also going to invite the person who wins the big prize to participate in his mastermind, which is valued at 20,000 plus the investment as well. So it's a big lucky winner will be super lucky. Yeah.
That's a value beyond the money.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
The investment is not that interesting from my point of view, as it is to have Bill Walsh as your partner, as your investor, and to promote your business to all his network. That's the biggest thing.
But how have him managed to build this $100 million dollars net asset, net?
Little by little. It's literally dollar by dollar. It's not
because
a big hit.
He's not Richard Branson, he's not Elon Musk, he's not in Romanian space known.
No, almost nobody knows him in Romania. Actually, he has been in Romania once, but not, the thing is that he knows how to grow business. His background is also like mine in venture capital and investment banking. He knows how to look at the business, he knows how to grow sales, and he knows how to optimize the business as well as the time of the entrepreneur and the people working for the business.
And he helped a lot of businesses to grow.
Yeah.
And he grew his fortune with this.
So now his events are like 20,000 people because he's so good and he gives so much value when he speaks and when he works with entrepreneurs. Yeah.
About the video, is it a good idea to start promoting your business in video? Because in video you shows everything. You can put a photo and the text and maybe you can fool a little bit the people
Video is a really effective tool, and there's two approaches to video.
Because to photo, if I'm a lady, I can put some filters and look 20 years younger.
Don't do that, do
no,
you?
No.
But in video, I have to
show... Have you got that 20 year younger filter on right now?
No.
Oh, I'm so disappointed in you.
No,
honestly, video is a really valuable tool and it doesn't require huge investment in technology. Now, if it's going to be a video on your homepage, it's worth putting a bit more investment into that and some professional input. But building informal video campaigns can be done with your smartphone. And it's a really valuable way of building live, interactive, authentic, you're absolutely right, authentic engagement with your core target audience. Every single SME can do that.
They say a lot of all the communication in the world will be video in the consumption.
Yeah. Now it's 85%.
Yeah. 85? 85%
of everything that is consumed online is video.
85%?
Yeah. So if you don't have video, you're only talking to 15% of your potential clients.
I didn't know that.
Now you know. So it's easier for you to sell your ads on your shows.
Do you think so?
No, video is so important.
And what else have you... learn about Romanian entrepreneurs until now, from their feedback, from their needs?
Anybody who's participated in any of the masterclasses I've run here are really committed. They are so committed to getting results. And we've given them the strategies and systems to implement and they follow through every step of the way. So, because it requires time, commitment, and also resources to invest in that, but every single one of them was very driven by ambition to get a result, and they come from very different different backgrounds, different types of professions, but each one of them, the overriding commonality is they're hugely committed to getting a result.
Do you think the marketing is the most important differentiator now between the businesses? Because we are in a period when many products can be doubled, can be copied.
Mm-hmm. But brand, you can potentially mimic let's call it a cheap ripoff. But brand is the big differentiator, the real authentic brand and how you build that out. So ultimately, brand is what enables you to command higher perceived value, to sell at a higher margin. But you have to put the work into developing that a brand with a very strategic approach to it.
Not only the work, but you have to resist the temptation, I need sales tomorrow.
Yes.
Let's count down the price because I need to survive tomorrow and I will see in the future.
And then
that's damaging the brand.
You're damaging the brand because you're like fundamentally building a brand is a marathon, not a sprint. So you've got to think long term. strategically, how am I going to get there? So yes, every business has got to operate on, yes, we've got to have good cash flow, what's our lowest hanging fruit, what's our easiest business opportunities, but what's our long term going to give us really solid growth at a higher margin with higher perceived value? Where can we build significant differentiation whereby we just leave all our competitors way behind?
And with what length in time do Romanians think in terms of their business?
Very short. They think tomorrow, I need sales tomorrow. And
they are the lucky ones.
They need today.
I need sales next hour. Okay, so these are the
lucky ones. They think really short term, and I think the biggest challenge is that they are not willing to invest in themselves. They're not willing to learn themselves so that they build a solid business,
yeah,
a solid brand and a solid business.
I was very sad to read the statistics that Romanians invest very small amounts, and only 1% of the Romanians go to some kind of courses or trainings.
Really?
Yes, 1%.
Yeah, it's very little. I don't have the money.
Compared with the Nordic countries, that more than 50% are going to some kind of courses or training or whatever.
But you know, what I see right now happening is that a lot of the Romanian businesses are falling big time. And the reason why that happens is because the entrepreneur is still stuck in the past and still stuck in the mentality, oh, I know it all, I don't need anybody to
and
help
it's,
me.
It's a mentality.
It's a mentality, yeah.
Because, of course, there are types of courses and teachings that are requiring huge investments, but you can go also to some lower offering, and is you cannot say, I cannot afford a book. Mm. Anybody can afford a book if they want to.
But what's it's a mentality. And what's most interesting is that people say, I can't afford to pay whatever, 1,000 or 2,000 for your services or for your boot camp. And then they go to a club and they spend 1,000 in one night.
It's true.
They go buy a Louis Vuitton bag to another, add another Louis Vuitton bag to their collection of another 10. But they don't have the 1,000 to invest in themselves and in their business that way.
Because they don't pay for that service $1,000, they lose in their business $100,000.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But they don't even understand and realize how much they lose yet, unfortunately, until they lose it.
If you evaluate all the most successful entrepreneurs and leaders in the world, they are committed as constant learners. They're committed to constantly learning, they're extensive readers, they're constantly working not only on their personal skills but on their professional skills and building their knowledge and depth. Certainly all of those that I've interacted with, they're all big readers, they're very well informed, they're constantly learning and developing. And certainly in a given year, I would certainly allocate budget on that on a constant basis. And those people are those who are the most successful.
Lorraine is the one who reads a lot, and she's like, come on, read more. And I'm like, I really don't like reading, but that doesn't mean that I don't get informed, right? I go to loads of events, I pay a lot of money on trainings and mentorship programs, and I consume a lot of digital products.
So what works for you?
Exactly. Yeah. So everybody needs to pick whatever works for them. For Lorraine, it's reading. For others, it's events.
Why it is important, and now we are going towards the end of our show, why it is important to pick up some wisdom from these type of international experts?
It just gives you a big jump, right? So you're wherever you are, and you can learn and eventually, in 100 years, get to that expertise by doing loads of mistakes and getting loads of frustration and getting stuck on the way. Or you just learn in one day from someone who's already there. It's as simple as that. If you want to do it fast, you get it from other people. If you want to do it your way, that's okay, but it takes you forever and it might never get to you. It's as simple as that.
Thank you very much, ladies. It was a pleasure.
Honor to be here. Thank you.
Thank you very much for watching us, and we'll be right back after a short commercial break. Thank you.